We're doing a sound check from the main microphone. Thank you all for coming today. It's very important for our family to sense the support that your presence brings. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. welcome this afternoon as we celebrate the life of Violet Cooper. I'm Pastor Jeff Potts. It was my privilege to be her pastor the last few years. Very special woman of God. And she leaves a powerful legacy to her family. Thank you for being here. Your love and your support means so much. It was just 1 week ago today that we were gathering at sunset around her bed and had worship together, family worship. Did some of the very same songs together that we will enjoy here today. But let's ask God to bless as we go through this service. Father God, we come before you now in the name of Jesus, so grateful for your love, your grace, so grateful for the wonderful hope that you've given us of eternal life. And we pray that as we journey together through the next hour or so, that you would grace this place with your presence, that you would touch each heart. Father, we thank you for Violet. We praise you for her and for the wonderful family that she raised, many lives touched over the years. And God, as we commit her to you, and as we reflect on her life and give you thanks for it, we pray that you would be honored here, that this would be a fitting and a beautiful memorial of her life, and that you would be praised. Thank you for being in our midst. Bring your healing. Bring your comfort. We ask it in Christ's name. Amen.
My name is Brian Hawes. I'm son-in-law, married to Karen. And I'd just like to thank so many people for coming out when we were deciding whether to meet here or somewhere else. We thought, well, Mom is 94 and probably not too many people would come, but this is really an honor. And I know Mom would be just thrilled to see all of her friends here to celebrate 94 years. And I was told that I'm to do the life sketch. And I thought I would be given a book. Instead, I got 2 pages. How do you do 94 years in 2 pages? But thank you, Lowell, for putting this together. We appreciate that. And I will share just some highlights along the journey of 94 years that some of you may be aware of and some of you it may not be aware of these events. So I'm going to read it as I have it. Violet Cooper Nee Boshe was born at her parents' home in the Robertson District south of Medicine Hat, Alberta, November 23, 1925. She was the 7th of 8 children, 5 girls, 3 boys, born to Fred and Emily Boshe. Violet attended a small country school for the first 9 years of her education. After that, she moved to Medicine Hat to attend high school and pursue her dream to become a teacher. Violet met Charles Cooper in 1944 at a prayer meeting at the Seventh-day Adventist Church, I believe there in Medicine Hat. Charles, at that time working as a colporter in Calgary, was a widower with a 3-year-old son, Stan. Affection between Charles and Violet began to blossom through correspondence. The long-distance relationship through mail developed into a FaceTime relationship when Charles and Violet exchanged wedding vows on May 21, 1945 in Medicine Hat. The couple set up home in Medicine Hat where Charles worked at a flour mill and Violet entered a career of raising family. Sometime after the birth of their first son, Lowell, the family of 4 moved to Brooks, Alberta, where Charles worked on a farm. They later moved to British Columbia in the Burns Lake and Babin Lake area and welcomed the birth of another son, Desmond. In 1949, the family relocated, this time to a farm some 8 miles north of Irvine, small hamlet in the southwest Alberta, where Violet says we raise cows, chickens, and kids. First daughter, Karen, was born on the way to the hospital in Medicine Hat, in the front seat of an old blue DeSoto car. 3 boys in the back seat were a captive audience. Some 2 years later, Violet made it all the way to the hospital for the birth of her second daughter, Catherine. The children attended school in Irvine. However, Charles and Violet nurtured a deep commitment to religious education of their children. There was no church school nearby, so when Stan was ready for high school, he was sent to the academy at Canadian Union College north of Lacombe, Alberta. The daunting cost of sending all their children to the boarding school prompted Charles and Violet to examine every option. In 1960, they sold the farm north of Irvine and moved to a small acreage outside Lacombe, just over a mile from Canadian Union College and its high school. This move provided opportunity for the children to attend church school. It also meant dramatic changes in work for their parents. Charles worked for a time in the furniture factory at the college, then later for building construction firms in Lacombe. Violet, on the other hand, took on the task of cleaning other people's homes besides her own. Charles and Violet opened their home for a period of time to the children of Violet's sister, Alice, who along with her son were killed in a car accident that also severely injured Alice's husband, Carl. A small Cooper home in Lacombe was overflowing at mealtime. Although Violet never realized her childhood dream of becoming a teacher, she did accept the challenge of managing a business. In 1977, she purchased a health food and Christian bookstore in Lacombe and named it Manamart, and served as a sole proprietor for the next 15 years. And during this time, Charles and Violet purchased a new home on T Road in Lacombe. Charles died November 2002 after suffering complications resulting from injuries sustained from a fall on an icy driveway in their home. In 2008, Violet sold the home on T Road and moved to independent living quarters in Royal Oak. On the evening of October 3, she fell and broke her hip. Hip surgery was performed in Red Deer, Alberta, and for a time, Violet experienced an amazing recovery. However, after medical problems arose, she passed to her rest, surrounded by family members, December 13, 2019. Violet is survived by one brother, Edgar Boucher of Medicine Hat, her children, Stan and Connie of Parksville, British Columbia, Lowell and Ray of Kennewick, Washington, Des and Trudy, and Kathy and Lee Patterson of Lacombe, and Karen and Brian Hawes of Pinoca. 9 grandchildren, 10 great-grandchildren, along with many friends. On November 23, Violet marked her 94th birthday in the Lacombe Hospital. In harmony with her wishes, her body has been cremated. Her ashes are buried alongside the grave of her husband, Charles, in Lacombe. In her last days at the Lacombe Hospital, she looked forward to rest, then the resurrection, and seeing Jesus face to face. And I know, as her son-in-law and spending much time in visitation, that nothing would make her happier than to have this reunion when Jesus comes, and that great day when she will meet Charles again, and by God's grace and blessing, meet all of you as well.
Hello, everyone. I especially feel thankful for Mother. When I was about 1 year old, my birth mother passed away from pneumonia. And he found himself, using his expression, in a conundrum. What to do with me? I spent time with 2 or 3 aunties. Dad decided to be a coal porter to support me somehow, and he decided to sell religious books and medical books. While working in the Medicine Hat area, Dad went to a prayer meeting in the church. He met a beautiful young woman. She spent weeks walking to the post office to collect love letters. In 1945, that beautiful young lady married my father and was willing to love a three-year-old boy. In the years that followed, I gained two brothers and two sisters. I know that they would agree that we had a most wonderful, God-fearing mother. Thank you.
Okay. I'm Des. I'm the middle child. Mom and Dad already had two boys. I was supposed to be a girl. And then there was Karen, and that was all right. She was a girl. And Kathy's the baby. She gets away with everything. So... yeah, so the middle children, they come with things. You know. Listen, we got to lighten up a little, because Mom knew how to make you laugh. That meant a lot. If she could just make you laugh, and that was the most grateful thing to her. Most times, unfortunately, it was at her expense. You know, and then as a result of her own actions, we'd... play a trick or two on her, and she would laugh along with us. And when we got to the punchline, she'd laugh again, and then a little while later, she'd ask one of the girls, "What was so funny about that? I didn't get it." Anyway, I think she'll make you laugh today. This story takes place back in the 70s, the 80s, somewhere around there. Remember AGT? Some people said it was, all got telephone. But it was actually Alberta government telephones. Now, Grandma's great-grandchildren, those that are here, and Spencer and Ava in the U.S., and Kelly, who is currently watching over in Denmark on live stream, you can't relate because you didn't have telephones with cords on them that were attached to a base on the counter. You can wander around all over the house. And you didn't have to have any wires or cables or anything. You just talk to whoever you want, wherever you are. Anyway, one day I called Mom from our home. And you only had to remember five numbers back. 26013. Now you got to remember 10 numbers. Anyway, I phoned her up. "Hello, Mrs. Cooper? Yes? Mrs. C.H. Cooper on T Road? Yes? This is Walter from the AGT station in downtown by the Widener Motors building. Des, is that you?" "No, Mrs. Cooper. This is Walter from Alberta Government Telephone."
Oh, it's the funniest thing. I have a son that sounds just like you. Well, I'll take that as a compliment. Thank you. Mrs. Cooper, how long have you been in that home? Well, let me see. It was built in 1972 by the Ozzie Sharman, the carpenter. And now it's 87, so 15 years. Mrs. Cooper, was that a new telephone in 1972? Yes. Well, we're servicing phones in that area today. You know, over that length of time, those lines get dust in them. So they even get cobwebs and sometimes little bugs. So we need to blow them out. There's no charge for this service. No charge? That's good. What do I need to do? Well, Mrs. Cooper, if you could get a plastic bag and put the receiver, the one that you're holding, into that bag, then maybe tie wrap it to the cord that's coming out of it so that the dust won't get all over the counter. You can even use a clear plastic bag if you want, and you'll see how much dust we blow out. Okay. So, I wait about 20 seconds, 30 seconds, and then I hear this. I just hung up and drove over to her house. When she came to the door, she knew she'd been had, you know? She was laughing. And she said, I couldn't find a plastic bag. I just used the paper one that the bread was in. I'll remind her of that earthly incident next time I see her. We'll laugh again.
I'm Karen, Violet's eldest, not oldest, daughter. Mom was so funny. And you know, it's just like at her birthdays. Every time we had a birthday for her, she'd say, oh, nobody's gonna come. Why bother? And so I really wanna thank you for coming today. That really means a lot to us. And for those of you who came and were turned away in the last few hours of her life, thank you for understanding. Mom had a really sweet nature, but you could be in trouble with her. That would have been trouble. So thank you for understanding. It was Mom's dream to become a teacher, and teach us she would. She would teach us mostly how to write properly, and she would teach us how to spell properly. When I asked her why she didn't continue her education, she said, well, after Dad rescued me from the farm and we got married, all you kids came along. I didn't learn much about their courtship, but one time Mom said that she and Dad were going for a walk, and she needed some help stepping over a stone or a log or something like that. And Dad reached out his hand and said, come on, kid. Well, she didn't like that so much. But it was kind of true. You see, she was 19, and Dad was 33. And he had a 3-year-old son to boot. So you can imagine. You know how that goes. And I said to her, well, Mom, was there a lot of chit-chat about, you know, Dad robbing the cradle? And she said, like, I don't care. So that was all good. Stan's mom died when he was about a year old. But pretty soon there were four more to add to the family. So you already know I was born in a car, not a barn. So I asked Mom, I said, Mom, how come you waited so long? You knew you were in labor. How come you waited so long to go to the hospital? And she said, well, when there's cows to milk and chickens to feed, you don't just up and go to the hospital. So then I said to her, well, you must have been really happy when I was born, because I was a girl. She said, you were so blue in the seat beside me, I didn't know what you were. So anyway, I think she was happy. The little farm was never their career dream. But as Mom put it, you did what you have to do to feed a bunch of kids and to clothe them too. And you know what I remember most about the, well, not most, but one of the things I remember about the farm was putting that cottage cheese on the line. You know how that was? And I think they call it clabber. Clabber is that soured milk that you put in a bag and then you hang it on the line and you let it drip for days. It seemed like for days anyway, until it got all curdy in the bag. You know what? That's still one of my favorite tastes. I love it. Clabber, what a name. I remember going to Medicine Hat every week. Couldn't remember the day of the week, but we did go every week. I think the whole family went, of course we would have. Selling eggs and cream and the butchered chickens. And I said, okay, Mom, butchered chickens, who held the head and who held the chicken? And she said, well, Dad held the chicken and I chopped the head. And then she looked away and she said, I don't know how I ever could have done that. But again, you do what you have to do. So one time, she was just telling us this not long ago, again. One time, just a day or two before market day, I was wheeling Kathy through the house in my doll buggy. I would have been 6, she would have been about 4. And up on the shelf was a big basket of eggs, like about 100. In there, and they were all washed and ready for market. Well, Mom said I was ripping through the house like a mad woman, and she said, you grabbed the basket to steady yourself because you lost your balance, and down came those eggs, all of them, over the doll carriage and over the person in the carriage. That wasn't good. Kathy was egged, the floor was all slippery, basket was all empty, and Mom was upset. She took Kathy out of that dripping egg mess, stood her on a mat beside the washstand and said, now you can just stand here until I get time to wash you up. She probably didn't say it quite like that, but anyway, sort of like that. So that's exactly what happened. Kathy stood there all the while singing, now wash me and I shall be whiter than snow. I don't know if she's ever sung that song since. Not sure. Well, after we all left home, Mom and Dad had time to themselves, maybe too much time. And of course, you understand that none of us gave her a lick of trouble and they lived happily ever after. Well, maybe not quite, but you know, family stuff's family stuff. So we won't go into that part. When Dad died in 2002, Mom managed to care for the house and the yard for 6 more years. And then at the age of 33, she moved into Royal Oak Independent Living, which she enjoyed for 11 years. After falling and breaking her hip on October 3 of this year, and she went through that surgery so bravely and unafraid, I remember the anesthesiologist telling me, you know, this is most likely to go the other way. And I said, I understand that, but we're going to go. And so Mom came through that, just amazing. and was doing really, really well with intensive physiotherapy. But I think she kind of lost her zest for living. She just felt like she was too old to be still here. And one day I said to her, "Mom, we need you for more reasons than one. Christmas is coming, you know, and you're the only one who can make the window box cookies and the oatmeal date cookies the way we like them." And then she again expressed her wish to die, and I said, "Well, I guess if it happens, it's all right, but we would be really sad." And she said, "Well, it clearly wouldn't be all right because you just said I had to stick around and make cookies." She could remember stuff, except when she couldn't. And on one occasion when she was fighting an infection, and she was so confused. She was saying things that just didn't make sense. So anyway, at one point I was over at her house, and I thought, well, I'm just gonna check and see if she can remember stuff. And so I asked her to name her kids. And she thought for a minute, and she said, "Well, Dez, no, Stan, Dez, Karen, Kathy." I said, "Well, that's only four." I said, "What about Lowell? Wasn't he born to you too?" And she said, "Oh, I think he just evolved." So I don't know, bro, if you're in the will or not. I have no idea. And then we'd take her, Kathy and I would often take her to doctor's appointments, and I know you and Trudy did too, Des, but several times when we'd take her to the doctor, and she loved Dr. Keller. Anything Dr. Keller said, no, that's what you went with. But anyway, we'd say to her, "Well, Mom, do you want us to come in with you?" And she'd say, "Well, I'd kind of like Dr. Keller to myself, but I suppose you should come." So we did. And one time when she needed, and I'm not sure I have this story totally right, was it a B12 shot, Kathy, that she was supposed to have?
No, she was getting her blood tested to see if it was too thin.
Oh, yes, she was going to have her blood tested to see if it was too thin because she was on blood thinners. And anyway, she phoned Kathy or told Kathy that she was going to get she was going to get her Special K shot. So that's what we kind of like to call Dr. Keller, Special K. And just a few weeks ago, I asked her, probably a couple of weeks ago in hospital, I'd ask her every morning, "Did Dr. Keller come in to see you?" And she'd always say yes. And the last morning that she could actually talk, I said, "Well, did Dr. Keller come in to see you?" And she said, "Oh yeah, he's a good guy." Mom's demise has left the world poorer, not just less crowded. So if you would, when you leave today, there's going to be somewhere, Marlon will take care of it, I know he will. There's going to be some mint patties, which was Mom's absolute favorite treat ever, clean out of the freezer. It had to be out of the freezer. That's when they were best. And anytime we went there, that's what we had for a snack, was the mint patties. And that is her sweet parting gift to all of you.
What a beautiful celebration of a beautiful life. It's a privilege to be a part of a beautiful family. Only one concern I have is there's too many preachers. I hear them all preaching. Lowell, you got some competition. My name is Lee Patterson, and I'm a son-in-law, Kathy's husband. And I've always looked at Mother Cooper and Father Cooper as the silent patriarchs. Their influence to me was very, very strong, but it was silent. They lived their lives in such a way that it was a privilege to witness. I have the opportunity to read Mother Cooper's favorite text. It's found, and it will be a familiar text to all of you, found in 1 John 1:9. But if we confess our sins to him, he is faithful and just to forgive us and to cleanse us from every wrong. God bless the reading of his word. Shall we just bow our heads for a word of prayer? Father, we thank you so much for this celebration that we can have in honor of you. For as Charlie and Violet have given their hearts, their lives, and dedication to you, they have made a little bit of heaven on earth. Please bless in the continuing of this service as it continues to honor you and recognize your children. Your child, Violet, as well. In Jesus' name, amen.
Good afternoon. I'm Lowell. Somebody needed to be normal in the family. You may have wondered, as you looked at the program today, there was a fourth instrumentalist in the group, and that fourth person, the young lady on the flute, is one of the 10 great-grandchildren. It wasn't known at the time the program was made that she would be able to be here. It's Paige Roy. She lives in Kennewick, Washington, and arrived last night. Thank you, Paige. Her parents are here as well. Thank you for coming and sharing laughs with us. It's necessary to do so because, you know, tears are such ill-mannered rascals. They come without being invited. So it's important that we have moments to laugh. One of the pictures you may have puzzled a bit. It was shown very briefly. And thank you, Marlon, for just a marvelous video. We're going to see that many times in our family. One of those pictures showed Mom and Dad in Indian garb. Mom was wearing a sari, and Dad was wearing a Pakistani lungi from a village in Pakistan. They came to visit us when we were in Pakistan, in India, I beg your pardon. They came to visit while we were in India. We had been in Pakistan, and that was very special to us. I'm not taking time to share memories other than this little one. When technology finally made it possible to make international phone calls without spending your entire bank account, I began the practice of calling Mom and Dad every Friday at 4 o'clock their time. And I suppose last Friday was maybe the first time in about 26 years when I haven't made a call. I would do so from anywhere in the world at 4 o'clock Mom's time. I would call her, and she would say, "Where are you?" And it may be, you know, in Asia, it may be in South America, in Africa somewhere. And I would say where I was. If I was traveling, I also called her when I was home. And When she realized I was overseas someplace, she would say, "Did you have to fly over the water again?" And I said, "Well, you know, I don't know another way of getting here, and I don't swim that well." And she'd say, "You know, I wish you'd quit traveling. I wish you'd stay home." "Why, Mom? I mean, this is my job." "Well, it stresses me out every time you fly over the water. What if the plane crashes?" And I said, "Well, Mom, I'm not sure there's a lot of difference if a plane crashes in the water or if it crashes on the land. I don't know that there's a lot of difference." "Well, it just stresses me too much." Yeah. So we came by road. Thank you for being here today. When loss is experienced, a loss that is shared is somehow made more bearable. And your presence today is incredibly important to us as a family. It also indicates that your life has been touched. You've been influenced in some way by Mom, and she's been influenced by you. She has talked, I think, nicely about all of you to us and appreciated so much the love that people expressed towards her. So we're here to mark, yeah, with some celebration, a wonderful life and a reasonably long life, I suppose. But secondly, we're here maybe subconsciously and certainly less willingly to wrestle with our thoughts about death. That's not pleasant. We surround death with beautiful flowers, marvelous decorations. This wasn't done for this memorial service today, but we happen to be occupying this place at a time when the decorations are still here, and they certainly add a sense of ambience to being in this place. But we have to deal with death. We cannot escape it. You can exercise till you're blue in the face, eat raw vegetables, nuts and fruits, and have semi-annual checkups. You can consume nutritional pills, but in 100 years or less, death will get you. It will. Maybe if you're rather exceptional, you'll live beyond 100. As of this morning, the oldest known living person is Kane Tanaka of Japan, aged 116 years, 352 days. She's counting days. The Guinness Book of World Records gave her a world record certificate. I think it was this May, when she became the oldest known living person. They gave her this certificate and a box of chocolates. And she opened the box immediately and began eating the chocolates. And someone asked her, "How many chocolates are you going to eat today?" She said, "At least 100. Yeah. Now, having passed her 94th birth anniversary, one might say that Mom lived a long time, at least when compared to a mayfly that has a lifespan measured in hours. On the other hand, 94, it's a bit short of Kane Tanaka's 116, and 352 days, almost 117. Even 117 is not all that long when you realize that a turtle died a few years ago in the Calcutta Zoo at the age of 250. A few years back, a date palm seed sprouted and grew into a tree. The seed was estimated to be 2,000 years old. The oldest known living individual tree is a Great Basin bristlecone pine with a ring count of 4,969 years. Still living. So, what about us? It's difficult to talk about death. Often there's a conspiracy of silence about the subject with people who are in their last days. Not so with Mom. We could talk to her about death. The last time we visited, not many days ago, we were, as a family, we were hoping to inspire her, give her some sense of a goal in life. And so one evening, the last evening that my wife and I were here, we walked down the hospital corridor with her a short ways, and she didn't do a lot of steps before she wanted to sit down, and then we pushed her in the wheelchair out to the area where we visited as a family. And in the course of conversation, I suggested maybe she could make some goals. It was December, you know, and maybe for the month of December she could have a goal of 10 more steps each day, you know. And by the end of December, she'd be able to walk from her room out to the lobby in the hospital. And she looked at me and she said, I have one goal in life. That is to go to sleep and to wake up in the resurrection and see Jesus. So it wasn't difficult to talk with her about death. And yet, death is a stranger, an alien, an intruder. It is not our friend. And civilizations all around the world throughout all history have struggled to talk about death. And when people and religions have talked about death, it has primarily been attempts to define it. If a young child grows up in a certain part of the world, that young child will be told, if you kill an enemy, you will go straight to heaven when you die. If that child is born somewhere else in the world, to parents of a different religion, that child may be told, when you die, you don't die. You are reborn into another form of life. You may become a chicken. You may become a cow. But you will be reborn into another form of life. In another part of the world, that child might grow up in a religion that says all the righteous will be resurrected. Or in certain parts of Asia, that child would learn that when one dies, one disappears into nothingness. Nothingness. It's hard to imagine, isn't it? Or there's the atheistic view expressed by Bertrand Russell back speaking about society in the 1960s, and he says, no dungeon was ever constructed so dark and narrow as that which imprisons us. There is darkness without, and when I die, there will be darkness within. There is no splendor, no vastness anywhere, only triviality for a moment, and then nothing. Well, in all these voices about death, there is yet one to be heard, and it is a voice that doesn't define death. It is a voice that speaks about death's defeat. When death becomes unwound. And that is the voice of Jesus. No wonder the poet John Donne could write those words, "Death, be not proud, though some have called thee mighty and dreadful, for thou art not so. Those who thou think'st that thou dost overthrow, die not, poor death, nor yet canst thou kill me. One short sleep past, we wake eternally, and death shall be no more. Death, thou shalt die." Theologians use an expression called the scandal of particularity when trying to fathom God's response to the predicament of this world and the whole human crisis. The scandal of particularity is that God acted at a particular time and in a particular place and in a particular way. He entered human existence through a particular person, of a particular height, weight, and complexion, of a particular race, and a particular village. And through that singularly unique drama effected the rescue of all time. Apart from what God has done, there is no other escape. And so today, we grasp this moment as we pay respect and to store in our memories the blessings that Mom brought to our lives. We gather here to assure each other that when it comes to carrying the pain of loss, we're all one family. We all know what death does to survivors. But let's also remind ourselves that though deeply saddened and uncertain of the moments, days, or weeks remaining in our own lives, we have no need to fear. No need to fear. For it is here in the face of death we discover that the great drama that is unfolding in our universe is a drama initiated and superintended by God. It's not about us, our jobs, our professions, our possessions, our skills, or our attainments. It's about what God is doing, about death. The gospel according to Mark tells us that on the resurrection morning, as three women made their way towards the garden tomb to anoint the body of one who had been crucified, they were asking themselves, "Who will roll away the stone from the tomb?" Now, we build our tombs differently today. And yet, that cartwheel of stone is a meaningful symbol. It speaks of the death that must come to each of us. It doesn't matter who we are, what we've done, death will come to us. And however much power we may exercise in this life, there will be a day when our power comes to an end. No human power has been found to defeat the power of death. This is the message of the stone. Who will move the stone? But scripture continues, when they arrived at the tomb, the stone had already been rolled away. What was beyond their power and means was not beyond the power and means of God. So this is the anchor point for navigating the sea of life. The story of God, of Jesus Christ, his death, resurrection, and lordship, is the one stabilizing reality in the chaos of our world. Isn't that why David in the Psalms can exult, "The Lord is my light and my salvation. The Lord is the stronghold of my life. Of whom shall I be afraid?" And then the Apostle Paul, writing to a troubled community of faith in the early years of Christianity, tried to galvanize their understanding about how to live in a problem-ridden world. He speaks about the possibility of hopelessness and despair, and then proclaims the news, "The fact is, Christ is risen. and in doing so, sounds the death knell of death itself. There's marvelous assurance in the words of Jesus to John the Revelator. Three times in Revelation, we are reminded that Jesus is the Alpha and the Omega. Those of you who have studied Greek, the beginning and the end, the first and the last. We journey through life with the expectation that the present shapes the future. But the message of Scripture contradicts that. The future is shaped by God. It's in His hands. He who is the beginning is also the ending. And now when we read papers and hear the headlines and go about the daily tasks of life, we can do so with a sense of eager expectancy. What God started, He will finish. And we shall be escorted not into nothingness, but into a life transformed beyond our wildest imagination. The realization that Jesus is in charge of the ending gives us freedom to experience the present without fear. Yeah, the path of our lives is often different from the scripting we would choose for ourselves, but we live in between a beginning and an ending that is in His hands. And while we are in this in-between time, we can know the security of walking hand in hand with the one who holds the future. In the truest sense, you know, every believer in Jesus Christ is a wait watcher. A wait watcher. You can work to clean the leaves off your, or the snow off your driveway, the leaves off of ours. You can work to obtain an education or follow a career. You can work to prepare a meal or build a house. But some things you cannot work for. You must wait for. You must wait for morning. You must wait for spring. You must wait for the resurrection. It's all a matter of time, not uncertainty. I think it was George Matheson who said, every schoolboy studies his books not by the light of the lamp, but by the light of the approaching holiday. Oh, is that not also an insight into the principle for Christian living? We live by the light of the approaching holiday. I want to conclude our thoughts, our meditation this afternoon with a picture. There it is, yes. In the Louvre Museum, the Louvre Museum in Paris, there's an oil painting from the 1819 by the French Romantic painter and lithographer Theodore Géricault. It's called The Raft of the Medusa. It depicts a moment from the aftermath of a wreck of a French naval frigate which ran aground off the coast of today's Mauritania in northern Africa. At least 147 people were set adrift on a hurriedly constructed raft. All but 15 died in the 13 days before their rescue. And those who survived endured starvation and dehydration. They practiced cannibalism. Both the shipwreck and the painting caused huge conflict and debate in France. Now, I'm not sure just what the painter had in mind. What was he trying to say in this painting? Maybe it was just to capture a memory that had been etched into the minds of a nation. But you know, a picture can be worth 1,000 words and sometimes 10,000 words. So perhaps this piece of skillful art can speak to us on another level. you will notice that the painting captures a moment at sunrise. Survivors on the raft are divided somewhat into two groups. The group in the near portion of the painting have their backs to the horizon. They appear despondent and resigned to the inevitability of death. One man cradles the naked body of another who obviously is no longer alive. The sailors have been overcome with despair. At the other end of the raft, the survivors are waving frantically at a tiny ship in the distance. They too have endured the suffering resulting from the shipwreck. They too have been spectators to the icy hand of death as day by day their comrades breathed their last. They too, perhaps, had resorted to cannibalism in order to survive. Now, here in the light of the rising sun, that silhouettes an approaching vessel, their days of grim adversity are dwarfed by the hope of a better future. Is that not an apt illustration of our lives? When we are at the end of our wits, when difficulties have developed into doubts and doubts into despair, when the day is dark and foreboding, when we come to the graveyard of our efforts and our abilities, we discover anew in the moments of worship that our God knows the way out of the grave. We worship someone who is from everlasting to everlasting. He is the Creator. He is trustworthy. He has promised an ultimate and enduring rescue from our earthly tragedy that opens into eternal life, eternal joy, eternal peace. He is worthy of our worship. And so I can say to Mom, sleep on. Sleep on. The chapter of your earthly life has ended, but the book has not. There's more to come. And to those of us who remain, I can say, go on. Go on. Live confidently until the dawn. Grieving the loss of a loved one is painful. It's not something we get over. It's something we learn to live with. In those dark moments of our lives, we must remember that in all our trials and tragedies, our source of strength, joy, and peace comes not from our ability to see God, but from the reality that He sees us. And that makes all the difference. So go on, with your faith securely anchored to the promise of Him who is Alpha and Omega, the Creator of beginnings and endings. As the poet Coleridge declared, "Is that a deathbed where a Christian lies? Yes, but not his. 'Tis death itself there dies."
My name is Judith Walters, and I've had many opportunities to visit with Violet and to have sang the song we're about to sing with her. I've also had many opportunities to laugh at her own jokes too. She would tell me her jokes and then she would laugh and I would laugh too. And so I just would like to invite you to stand as we sing her favorite song in the hymnal, "I'm a Child of the King."
My Father is child of the King, a child of the King, with Jesus my Savior, I'm a child of the King. My Father's own Son, the Savior of men, once wandered on earth as the poorest of them, but now he is pleading our pardon on high, that we may be his when he comes by and by. I'm a child.
Well, before we have the benediction, just a word of information as to what follows. It was felt it might be most convenient if we didn't ask you to go outside and have a picnic brunch or lunch or to travel to some other location for some refreshments. So refreshments are being provided right here. You can see that we may be stressed for capacity a little bit, but please don't leave. The refreshments will be available, and if you want a place to sit, come back into the chapel and sit and visit. We thank you so much for coming today. I invite you to bow the head as we have our benediction. Our gracious Father, here in these solemn moments where we think deeply about life and death, we want to thank you for the life and love and leadership of Mom, to acknowledge the ways you've blessed us through her, and to recognize in this moment of parting how deeply entwined human lives can be, and to affirm that you are our Lord, our God, in whom we trust. Thank you for the blessed hope. Teach us to live with our eyes fixed on the things of eternity, our minds fortified by worship. In a special way, bless all those, indeed, I believe it is all of us, who have been burdened by sorrows thrust upon them by the loss of a loved one, maybe recently, maybe long ago. And yet that burden is something that is still carried. May each one know the blessing of your presence and the certainty of your promises. Now may our Lord Jesus Christ himself and our God and Father, who has loved us and given us everlasting consolation and good hope by grace, comfort your hearts and establish you in every good word and work. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Thank you. And our benediction serves also as the grace for the meal. Enjoy.